Yes, everybody, here we are, televangelist number six, Peter Popoff. And here you see him performing what can only be described as scam eelings. This man has been around for a long time, and unfortunately, he's still around. This telecast is from only a couple of years ago, which leads you to believe that a lot of people just want to be duped, I think. It's hard for me to feel sorry for some people because this man has been exposed over and over again. He was first exposed by the fabulous, amazing Randy, who is a magician and illusionist. I mean, he says that most magicians and illusionists, like the amazing Randy, Penn and Teller, they say up front, it's all fake. It's all fake. But they are uniquely poised to be able to spot another BSer. And that's exactly what James Randi did. He actually went undercover with audio detecting devices at some of Popoff's tent revivals and recorded Popoff getting information from his wife that would tell him things about who to call on. He got information about plants in the audience. About who would be playing. Here is his lovely wife who basically participated in that scam and that deception. So that was well known. But yeah, he still keeps coming back. Recently, he got into trouble with the with the Food and Drug Administration about selling all healing natural spring waters. These people just don't stop. And Peter Popoff, like Oral Roberts, like Pat Robertson, has been around for years and will probably continue to be around because they're like a fungus that keeps coming back, and we just haven't found a fungal, an antifungal strong enough to kill them. It's like that bad case of athlete's foot that keeps coming back. And if you want to buy some of his miracle spring water, there you go. Go right ahead. I would advise you not to. If you're gonna call this number, unsubscribe from my channel. I'm just saying, because we're all about truth and exposing frauds over here. I have no problem with legitimate people of God. I may not believe in God, I may not believe in religion, but people that are legitimately in the business of caring for others, donating to hospitals, volunteering their time, counseling the sick, counseling those in prison, I'll donate to them. I may not believe in what they, propose as the granddaddy in the sky. But I can certainly get behind a real need to help people. But there's a big difference between those people and these hucksters. So let's join in on another Keto and Classic. This is 2018 Tracy telling you about huckster Peter Popoff.
Hey everyone, Keto Comic here, coming to you live from Los Angeles, California, in our truck. I'm recording outside because I don't want to wake up the wife and the other animals. Me and my little buddy Teddy, my little miniature poodle, he's napping in the back while I do this. So I thought I would go ahead and bring you today's video. Peter Popoff, we're delving into the world of televangelists. This will not be the only televangelist I cover. This was just, to me, one of the most well-known, one of the most sinister cases of it. If you're not familiar with what televangelists or faith healers are, which he technically had a faith healing ministry, if you go to late night television or any religious channels, you'll see these huge, huge meetings and church and mega churches with his pastor speaking in tongues and getting real hyped up and kind of a country rockabilly kind of music going on. And you'll also see them offering to heal people. And you'll see people come up, they'll lay their hands on them, they'll fall backwards, they'll tell them to feel the power. But the key is on the people they heal, it's always of ailments that can't be seen. Ulcers, headaches, stomach cancer. They'll get them hyped up, they'll get them emotional, they'll tell them to feel the heat, feel the fire. And of course, when you're in that excited moment, you do feel all this, and so probably in that moment of elation with the endorphins flowing, you do feel that you're healed. And so a lot of these people will think that they're healed and then go to the doctor and their cancer's still there, their ulcers are still there, or they'll go to or they'll believe it so much they'll stop going for treatment altogether. And anyway, that's the type. And so all of these types of healing ministries, they often heal things that can't really be seen with the human eye. You never see them regrow an amputated limb. You never see them restore somebody's vision, or really restore somebody's hearing. You never see them heal something that could be seen with the human eye. It's always something that a person has to take on faith until a doctor confirms or denies it. So that's how these people make their living, and he is one of the worst. So let's get into it. Peter Popoff. I don't want you to think that this faith healing thing's a new phenomenon. I remember it when I was growing up. I remember seeing healings take place in my own Pentecostal church. I also remember my grandmother watching these guys on television and actually believing it. She sent them money to the day she died. And this has literally been around since religion has been around in the US and in Europe. This started with preachers going from church to church, preaching revivals, doing healing ministries. It also, in the days of the Old South and Midwest, you had people traveling with tents, setting up tents, having these huge revivals, taking in thousands of dollars, sometimes a night, for people believing they were helping a worthy cause. So this has been around a long time. So Popoff is not the only one out there, and he's certainly not the only con man that has used this to make a buck. It's been around for a long, long time. I think it's probably as old as the snake oil salesman. It's just a different form of snake oil sales. Remember the old, there used to be medicine shows in the old West and even in the East where people would pull in with wagons touting a magical elixir, and they would tell it cures all, cures all. Coca-Cola started as a magic elixir. And they would give people this, and it cures everything, and people would believe it. And sometimes their ailments would get better through psychosomatic thought, but really the elixir did nothing, just like these faith healing ceremonies do nothing. So this has been a long history of deception in the United States. We as a people tend to be pretty gullible. But let's get into Popoff himself. Popoff was born July 2nd, 1946, in West Berlin, Germany, in occupied Berlin, West Germany. If you'll recall, was the portion of Germany that was divided among Great Britain, the United States, and France after World War II, whereas East Germany remained in the hands of the Soviets. He was born there with his father George and Gerda, his mother George and Gerda Popoff. Ironically, his father was a minister, and he immigrated the family to the United States shortly after Popoff's birth. And he was a traveling tent evangelist. So this went on even in Europe, as I'd said before. He traveled from town to town, city to city, with his family in tow, preaching these types of services. So Peter grew up in this. He grew up seeing this, grew up knowing it was the family business, and he just followed in his father's footsteps. In fact, Peter himself was prompted in his father George's ministry and pamphlets and things like that as a miracle child, and we'll get into that. But suffice it to say, he started preaching from a very young age. About the age of 14 is when he preached his first sermon for his father. Just a few more specifics on Popoff's background. He attended Chaffey College and later on the University of California, Santa Barbara. He married his wife Elizabeth in 1970, and they went on to have three children, Amy, Nicholas, and Alex. And he and his wife are still married to this day. Has been a long-standing marriage. She was his business and ministry partner, which will show her involvement in the scandal a little bit later on. And they still live in California. So it's not just the South, not just the Midwest that gets this. A lot of this stuff comes out of the West as well. Let's continue. As I said, Popoff traveled with his father, who was also a tent evangelist, and from a very early age, he saw this as his family business. His father taught him this is the way to go. Also taught him the tricks of the trade, and he began using, because children that could preach were kind of a novelty. They drew a crowd because it was a curiosity. Even non-religious people would come to watch these children preachers. So Popoff's father, George, promoted Popoff as a miracle boy preacher, and put out all kinds of pamphlets and propaganda on him, even stating that Peter had been born in a West Berlin bomb shelter, and was their family was rescued from a Siberian prison camp, after which Peter was revealed to have these wonderful healing powers. So it was all bullshit. It was just a way to make a buck. And this is not the first highly publicized case of a child preacher. We go back to the case of Marjo Goitner, who was actually a little bit younger than Peter, but there was actually a documentary film made on him in the 70s called Marjo. It won the 1972 Academy Award for Independent Film. And it's a marvelous documentary. It really goes inside what happened. This kid, Marjo, was put out by his evangelist parents as a miracle boy. And I'm going to insert a few clips of him preaching.
Be able to escape suffering. Your suffering will be so bad that it'll turn to weeping. And then the weeping shall turn to wailing. And then the wailing shall turn to gnashing of teeth. I say hell is a place of memory. In hell, you'll remember things. Let's refer to the rich man and Lazarus. Abraham said to the rich man, Son,
And also, during this documentary, it showed what happened. Marjo realized as a young child that he was being deceptive. He didn't like it. He knew it was all bullshit. So he kind of left and then realized he couldn't make a living doing anything else because he was Marjo. He was Miracle Marjo. So he came back and got back on the evangelist, 10 evangelist circuit as a young man in his late teens, early 20s, and this documentary film crew followed him around, and he gave them unfettered access, and he showed them what went on behind the scenes. A lot of drinking, a lot of sex, a lot of talking about how you fool people into giving you money. He even commented that a preacher once told him that always say somebody out there has a $100 bill in a cookie jar because somewhere there's a little old lady that has a $100 bill in a cookie jar and she'll send you that. If you get 10 little old ladies sending you their $100 bill, that's $1,000. And he would use mental tactics like that, like saying somebody has a $5 bill, somebody has a $20 bill. Well, there's a lot of people who are going to have those things. So that's how these people get money. They use mental tricks to make the people believe that God is speaking through them to them, give me all your money. Well, he gave these people unfettered access and really brought down his own ministry. He had another twinge of conscience and brought down his own ministry with this documentary. And after it was over, he retired from the ministry. He apologized and he went on to be an actor in Hollywood, starring in some movies, actually. So this has been around a long time, and Popoff was one of those kid preachers that were kind of exploited. So you wonder if you can blame him or his parents. I mean, certainly his parents were to blame in the early days, but once you reach an age where you know it's wrong, then you have to have a enough of a conscience to stop doing it, just like Marjo did. But Peter didn't go that way. Peter's kept running with the family moniker and continued fooling people into believing he was a faith healer that could heal them of their disease. Well, he started, after many years on the circuit with his father, he decided it was time to start a television ministry, which he did. He started filming a show. He got it put on several local channels around the country, as well as religious television. And his premise was raising money for Bibles to send to the people of the Soviet Union, because the Soviet Union was an atheistic government, and they like their people to be atheists as well. So there wasn't a whole lot of religion. Religious w really wasn't promoted in the Soviet Union, so people had a hard time getting literature. Now, I'm an atheist. I don't really hold religion to a high regard, but I do believe people have the freedom of choice. If you want to be religious, if you do feel that's your path, by all means go for it. And I don't think anyone should have the ability to stop you from doing that. So I applaud him for getting Bibles for people who may have wanted them. But that's literally where his good works stopped. Financial audits later on would reveal that most of the money did not go for Bibles. In fact, it went for further production of his show, salaries for he and his wife, and promoting his still traveling tent ministry. So, in 1986, he drew the attention of the amazing Randy, James Randy. Randy ran the Committee for Skeptical Inquiry. This is actually a pretty neat little thing. He has a challenge, a $1 million challenge out to people that profess to have supernatural ability, whether it's preachers, psychics, magicians, whoever. If you can actually prove under test conditions, that is controlled conditions, that you have this power, James Randi will write you a check for $1 million. He's never written a check in the whole history of his committee. But James Randi is a magician and a skeptic. What's ironic is most magicians you meet are skeptics. They're not religious. They don't believe in supernatural. They know that being a magician's all parlor tricks. I know a few of them myself. And James Randi was one of the best. He his two proteges were Penn and Teller. If you know Penn and Teller from Penn and Teller's Bullshit, they all worked together for quite a while. They regard Randi as teaching them many, many things. So James Randi and his committee turned their gaze toward Peter Popoff in 1986, saying he was a fraud, and they set out to prove it. This is coming off the tale of in the 70s, they had exposed psychic Uri Geller with the help of Johnny Carson on The Tonight Show. Johnny Carson, another magician and skeptic. And they used Johnny's platform as a means of exposing Uri Geller. Uri Geller was a psychic that was praised for his ability to bend and manipulate objects. He could bend spoons, run his hand over metal containers and let you know which one had water in it without ever touching them. And I'm going to show you some clips of him as well.
Running. And that when the 10 minutes is over, there's a total reaction to that. And you can work that out in half an hour of filming.
But what is wanting it to happen off camera? He wanted you to film those things. Why do it when the camera is running? Where do you get?
Obviously, we're suggesting that he couldn't do it while we were watching him play.
Yes, it's going.
It's going.
It's going.
Oh, yes, that's fantastic.
Just when we thought he wouldn't do anything when the camera was running, we seem to be proved wrong.
It's breaking.
Like in on the joint.
It's breaking, I think, now. It's look, it's becoming plastic, and there is no heat. Look, very gently.
Sideways to me and bend it a little.
It's fracturing, I think.
Like this?
Is that right?
I turn it around the other way, that's it.
Look, it's fracturing. Please go, please.
But he actually submitted to a test put forth by James Randi on the Johnny Carson show and failed the test. His amazing psychic powers failed him. But basically what it was, the spoons and things like that he could bend by rubbing his hand across it, what James Randi discovered is that they were very cheaply made, or ones that had already been heated up and weakened. And when he ran his finger across them, the friction would cause just enough heat that they would actually start to loosen and bend. Well, on The Tonight Show, they gave him actual spoons that had not been manipulated of a good grade. He couldn't produce anything with them. They asked him to choose which one of these metal containers had the water in it. Ones that had been placed by him, by The Tonight Show, not Uri Geller himself, and he could not do it. And he blamed it on the audience being too skeptical, that their energy was fading him out. So he was essentially exposed as a fraud.
Claims to have psychokinetic powers, and that is the power to affect objects, sometimes by moving them, bending them. Audience at home, that he has not touched these objects in any way. They were brought over here by our property man. The table was placed here. And while we have been away, you have not touched them in any manner. I will verify that.
So I'll just move my hands over them, and if I'll feel for...
And one of them contains water, of
the
10. I
like to do it the way we'll start eliminating the ones that do not have the water. That's the way I did it at SRI. That's the way I'll try to do it here.
All right, without touching them.
Without touching them, of course.
All right.
And why don't you pick out the... When I say take this out,
I
pick
take
it out.
Right,
so
of course.
That means there's no water in that. I'll try to go down. Now, what I do now is try to have a sort of a feeling where...
You mentioned something. You said if the audience helps you concentrate, if they help you think about...
Oh, yeah, it helps. I mean, it helps to a sort of to a limited extent, but I'm the one who will have to choose from here, not you.
Now, so in these demonstrations, Yuri, very often you say you do fail.
Oh, well, you
and
see,
do the audiences accept
let me tell
it?
You this.
Do they accept it?
Yes, I don't force anybody to, first of all, I don't force anybody to come to my appearances and believe me. You see, there it is, and I'm trying to do and succeed.
And James Randi sought out to expose Peter Popoff in the same way. he and his crew started attending Popoff's evangelist meetings. They snuck in. He had a feeling because Peter Popoff had a reputation of being able to recite and call people out from the audience. He knew everything from their address to what ails them to the names of people they wanted him to pray for. He knew all this information, and he would call it out and get people to, you know, they would raise their hands and walk forward after he called on them. And what James Randi noticed when he got there is that people were filling out information cards that were picked up by Popoff's people and taken backstage. Well, he said, okay, that's how he's getting his information, but how is he getting the information to his ear while he's on stage, because he's certainly not memorizing all that. So he had the idea, James Randi had the idea of bringing in a police scanner, which he did, and he put an earpiece in, he started listening, and he started to scan the airwaves, and eventually he came across a broadcast going on in the building where Peter Popoff's wife was feeding him all the information off these cards.
But I'm willing to give that up in order to live in an actually real world, as close as I can get to it. During the 1980s, I entered a world that I found filled with fantasy and rife with abuse. The world of faith healing. At the time, Popoff was pulling in nearly $4 million a year healing people on his miracle crusades.
You've got cancer of the stomach? Are you ready for God to burn that cancer out? Here it goes in the mighty... Devil, back off. Back off, devil! Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
You really believe you're healed?
Yes.
You think your cancers are gone now?
Yes, I believe that, because God never lies, and we stand in His word.
Afflictions they'd come to cure.
God is touching that thyroid condition right now. God is touching your nerves right now. God is touching your eyes. Just lift up your hands, get ready, here it comes.
He also knew the personal details of their lives.
You're going to hear good news from Charles before everything is over. I'll tell you, he's going to be completely delivered because of your prayers, because of your faith. Here it comes, complete healing in Jesus' mighty name, right now, right now, right now. Amen. It's all right to praise the Lord.
I suspected that Popoff's revelations were other than divine.
Hello, Petey, can you hear me? If you can't, you're in trouble.
Popoff was being prompted by his wife through a wireless earpiece.
John?
Dearly Johnson.
She'd gotten her information from prayer cards filled out by the faithful before the show began.
She's about to get rid of the walker.
You want to get rid of this walker, sister? Oh, glory. How long have you been walking on that walker?
About 3 years.
3 years.
She lives at 1627 10th Street.
1627 10th Street?
Is that right?
That's right.
She has arthritis all over.
Burning this arthritis right out of your body. Take a few steps just to make the devil mad. Hallelujah. That's it. Just move around a little bit. There she goes. Just walk with me. Oh, glory to God. She's not going to need that walker anymore. God's just putting new strength, new health, burning that arthritis out of her body. Just keep going. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I was able to arrange for another broadcast of the miracle.
And not only that, they were saying some pretty heinous things about these people that came out to support his ministry. In one inclination, his wife actually told him, hey, Peter, see that big N-word in the back? That's the one you want. They also made fun of people's appearances. She made little jokes like, keep your hands off that woman's tits. I'm watching you. And then they could hear other ministry members in the background laughing at people, laughing at the jokes, and it was just heinous. So James Randi recorded one of these broadcasts while he was there and took it on Johnny Carson. They offered Popoff the opportunity to come on to refute it. He, of course, refused, and they exposed him again on the Johnny Carson show. And that was in 1986. Peter Popoff said these were all tools of the devil. They were just out to get him. The devil wanted to close down his ministry. Well, it had its desired effect. And Popoff's ministry declared bankruptcy in 1987. September 87, he declared bankruptcy. He had more than 790 unpaid creditors, though the financial auditors and trustees that handled the bankruptcy said that had more to do with just financial mismanagement than being exposed. Because they were saying that even though that kind of cut off a flow of people that believed him, that even if that hadn't happened, eventually he would have gone bankrupt just because the ministry was broke. They had spent the money in a very lavish way. They had property and mansions and, you know, all this stuff that a lot of these televangelists have. And that was why they went bankrupt. The process that James Randi went through just sped that up and also exposed him as being a fraud. Popoff disappeared for about 11 years. No one saw him, but he made a comeback. 1998, late night television, he was back with an infomercial for Miracle Spring Water. This was Miracle Spring Water from a golden spring in Russia that was said to have properties of healing and protection. He even went so far as to say that people that were exposed to Chernobyl, the ones that had drank from the spring, were not affected by the nuclear fallout. And people believe this, and he sold them little metal containers of this water for love gifts of no less than $100. So $100 for a little bottle of spring water that he said was blessed, and that they would drink it, whatever they need they had on their heart or their mind at that time would be healed. And people believed him and started sending him thousands of dollars for this, until a former staffer that had been fired, and I know that's kind of skeptical, but she actually came forward and admitted that this water came from Costco, that she was actually one of the ones that went and bought cases of just the Nestle Pure Life water, spring water, and bottled in California, and would bring it back. They would open the bottles, pour them into smaller containers, and send them out to the faithful for money gifts. Now, take it what you will. She was fired, so she could have had a vendetta, but suffice it to say, he's up to his shenanigans again, and he's still around. I mean, he's 76 years old. You still, if you're flipping through late night actual television, like here in the RV, we have an air antenna that we can watch local stations. And sometimes just flipping through late at night, I'll see Peter Popoff still doing his thing, still hawking his miracle water. And it's amazing to me how any other kind of fraudster can be exposed for what they are. But yet these televangelists, these faith healers, who to me are doing the greatest amount of harm to people, getting them to believe that they're healed when they're not, perhaps influencing them not to take medicine that they need, guilting people out of their last dollar. They're like a weeble. You know, a weeble that wobbles, but they don't fall down. The toys that you can knock down, do all kinds of stuff with, and they'll never stay down. They're like those. They're the never-ending weeble. You can't get rid of them. And it's just amazing to me how they still flourish, even though they've been exposed many, many times. But anyway, guys, that's the story of Peter Popoff. It's short and sweet. Beware of these fraudsters, these tricksters. And I'll be back real soon with another scandalous true crime story. And thanks so much. Like, comment, share, subscribe. Be sure you're listening to my new podcast, Thought Crimes. I know you'll enjoy it. And I really love you guys. Thank you so much. Ketosis, y'all. Keto Comic. Out.